Say, Father, thank you,
for
your word.
We hear it.
We believe it.
We
receive
it.
Have your way.
We
pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, have you ever asked the Lord, you know, Lord, do I really matter? All right, then. Hello. It's like, you know, remember that old song from Queen from my hippie days? Is anybody out there? I know it was before your time. But sometimes we find ourselves in one of the worst battles of all is when the enemy lie and tell us that we don't matter. What we think don't matter, what we say don't matter, what we do don't matter, what we believe don't matter, we don't matter, whether I would be here or not, what difference does it make? We need to know how to war against that, because I believe that each and every one of us matters a whole lot more than we think. All of us matter. There is no one higher than the other. We are all so precious to the Lord. We have one God. His name is Jesus, and we are the members of the body of Christ. There's just one body, and there's one head. And the Lord, as the head, he cares about every member. And what you think, what you believe, what you say, it matters. Your voice matters. It was life-changing for me when I realized that it mattered. It made a difference. And sometimes I would think, but Lord, it's only what I think versus what everybody else. The Lord says, but I'm the head. So don't pay attention to the other members. Know how valuable you are, because everybody's always looking for validation. That's everything that fell when Eve fell, or Adam, or both of them, they're still talking about it. Still not sure who did what first, but what failed was the freedom to be free to be whoever you are. To be free to be and know that God was with you, in fellowship with you. You would walk with God, you would talk with God, you would be with God, you were naked with God. No, it's the truth. Then the fall came and they were hiding themselves. Because then suddenly, I have to hide me. I have to hide who I am. Who I am doesn't really matter. When I was young and I would smoke weed, don't look at me with that tone of voice. I used to be a hippie, like an acid queen. Like those LSD 25, I would pop them, and my head got popped. We'll keep that for another day. But I remember getting so paranoid. I mean, super paranoid. You know, like if you see one police car, you know for sure it's coming after you. The other day I was driving, and there was the police behind me. And suddenly I'm looking, well, how fast am I driving? You know, you think, you know, as my license plate expires. My light working. You know, you're thinking, okay. Especially because it was in a 30 miles per hour zone, and I have this sweet car. It's not my fault. But my car likes to go fast. It doesn't obey me right, you know? So I look, and it says 30 miles, you know, the sign, and my car, not me, I had nothing to do with it. Michael said 37. So I take my food off and I say, oh, Lord, are the lights going to flash suddenly? He said, no, don't worry, your lights are flashing higher. So then I was like, but I remember a time in my life that not only I didn't really know that I mattered, but I really would take on what everybody would say. I would be fearful to whatever comes my way. And I would even have fear of rejection, which is even worse. God bless you, even if you don't have chum. And to me, part of not being deceived in these latter days, because deception come easily. How do we guard from deception? Because not only we have to know that we matter, but we cannot be taken away by things that might appear to be one way. And they might be another way. We have to have the discerning of spirit. You remember the story with Joshua, with the Gibeonites? And they come and they have raggedy clothes and they have raggedy garments and holes in their wineskin and all that, and they look like they just come from far away, and they tell Joshua, yeah, we come from far away, help us. And the reason that Joshua got deceived is the scriptures say he didn't seek counsel of the Lord. Because if we don't think we matter, then we don't think that what we have to ask matters to the Lord. If I don't think what I believe matters, and if I don't check with the big guy, am I on the wrong track? I mean, there's nothing wrong to be on the wrong road when you get to be 62 years old. And then to find out, oops, I was supposed to be a dentist. Because at 62 would be hard for me to learn to be a dentist. You know, every day we have to seek counsel of the Lord. We have to know that it matters to us. That story reminds me, you know, one day we had somebody come and ask us for food or money or something. And then the person, I think, I don't remember if we gave him $10 or $20. And then we see him come out and he gets into his big, beautiful, was it a hammer or a hummer? A hummer. Now thinking, you're looking like you have the need, but you're trying to deceive me. How many people I've ministered to in the life of ministry that would tell me, Pastor, I got deceived. I married this person. Uh-huh. Ah. Sounded like that person was a Christian. It said the words were right, and they even said they would do A, they would do B, they would do C. We got married. We had the honeymoon. And then, poop, Dr. Dyke Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It's like Jacob that goes to sleep. He gets married, one sister, Rachel, remember? And he wake up with another. Now that'll mess up your day. And you would be like, right? And then he got deceived. Because Laban made him work for 7 years. So not only get deceived, but then the father says, hey, if you want the other sister, you get to work for me for 7 years. You read a lot of stories in the Bible where people got deceived. They got deceived. How do we get to guard against deception? As we know that not only we matter, but everything that pertains to what God has for us matters. The key is to remember who He is, to remember who we are, to seek Him above all, seek Him, His righteousness, to be able to read His word, to know what His word says, and if it says it, I believe it. And the key is to be able to be so strong, not to be so quick in going by the appearances. Right? So if I minister to someone, it happened to me just not long ago, and they said, well, I realize I get deceived the day after we get married, and I've been trying to make it work for 20 years. What do you do? I mean, religion says, hey, you know, you have to stay married. But then suddenly you find yourself, you're married to an unbeliever, and you've been deceived. What do you do? I say, suffer the rest of your life. No, just you should have seen your faces. Oh, that was so funny. I should have taken a picture. Oh, yeah. We have to seek the Lord. Because every situation is different. You cannot take one situation and make rules. I'm so tired of religion, of rules. I love the freedom that I have in Christ. I love the way I can seek the Lord and ask Him for what He has, and I can expect an answer. But I can expect an answer because I know I matter to Him. I know if I ask Him something, He's going to make a way for me to hear. He's going to make a way for me to hear. But if I ask other people before I ask Him, then I might get deceived. Because I don't know what they're thinking. We have the armor of God. That's the armor of God. Represents Jesus. He represents who we are in Him. And every piece of the armor, when you think about it, you war with who you are. Every piece of the armor represents even your protection against deception. To me, the key is against the deception is to confess the Lord. To confess means to come in one accord, to come in agreement with who He is, with His word. And I come in agreement with Him, I confess the Lord. The same way that we read in Romans for salvation. I'm going to find Romans. I'm so drunk of the Holy Ghost. Whew. Can you feel, is it hot in here to you? It's really hot. I can't find Romans. Romans, get out of my Bible. It's not my fault, it's like my car. Romans just disappeared. It's after the gospel, so you have to go back to all the gospel, the book of Acts, and then comes Romans. And then you put your glasses and you think, oh, I have a big letter Bible. And then you go to Romans 10. Man, I can't wait until the Lord, He reveals so much truth that all the darkness flees. But in Romans chapter 10, it says in verse 9 that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Wow. For the scripture says, whoever believes on Him will not be put to shame. Whoever believes on Him. Whoever believes on Him will not be put to shame. When you don't know if you matter, it's because there's the root of rejection, of shame. But whoever believes on Him will not be put to shame. You will never have to tell somebody, I feel so sorry for having believed in God. You will never have to tell somebody, oh, I wish I would not have confessed. that the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ. You will never have to be to have to find an excuse for having believed your God, because your God, he tells you, you will never be put to shame. If you believe in me and if you believe in my word and my word abide in you, you have to know that I'm watching for you. I got your back. I got your back. Even if you miss it sometimes, I will make sure that I lead you on the right way, because in your heart, you believe in me. There's something about believing God. Here it says, if you confess, if you believe that he's Lord, not just Savior, but Lord. To me, this to confess is like to profess with your mouth. And I know sometimes we're trying to process things, but we don't say the right things. But it's out of the heart that the mouth speaks. The helmet of salvation that we have means that what we think matters. What we believe matters. Because you have the mind of Christ. You're a child of God. Maybe before you didn't think you mattered, but now once you believe, then the Lord wants to bring truth to you. You have the belt of truth. You have the belt of truth. And you know, I often say it's not for you to pull it and choop on people. Boom. The Bible says, schlag, schlag, schlag. Pulling out your belt. That's not what the Lord had in mind. The Lord says you have your belt of truth, because whatever you believe in my word, you can stand on it. It matters. I'm going to lead you to know that what you think matters because of the helmet of salvation. I'm going to lead you to know that what you say matters because of the sword of the Spirit. It matters what you say. Your voice matters. What you hear matters. Guard your ears, guard your heart, pay attention, because the enemy wants you to just totally think, no, my voice doesn't count. Yeah. It does, because your voice added to my voice, to your voice, to your voice, to your voice, makes a whole lot of noise. Makes a whole lot of noise. The breastplate of righteousness, the enemy, the deception that it tells people is you have no value. You're not worthy. You're not righteous. Well, then I confess the Lord and I confess I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am accepted in the Beloved. I am more than a conqueror. Oh, hallelujah. The enemy comes and he tells you what you do don't matter. Yeah. Say, no, what I do matter. I have my feet shod with the shoes for the preparation of the gospel of peace. Yes. Everything that I do in his name. It matters. Yeah. Even if I ever think that I don't matter, it's him that matters to me. Therefore, who I am in him matters. You hold down the word of God with the sword of your spirit, and you speak forth the truth of God's word. You put restraining order against them. I've been putting restraining orders against enemies. I don't even know if I have them. I just figured every morning I put a restraining order against every evil that's trying to come against me. Every tongue that rises against me in judgment, I condemn it now. Hallelujah. I confess that Jesus is my Lord, not just my Savior, but my Lord. And I come in agreement with everything that he says about me. And he says I am the apple of his eye. He says he will never leave me nor forsake me. He says he's my King, he's my Lord, he's my Savior, he's my healer. He says that if I confess things to him, he will forgive me of all of our righteousness. There's something about being able to walk in truth when you're dealing with something. Because if you confess your sins, even the Bible says that if you confess to one another in order that you may be healed. Well, when I was young, I thought to confess meant to go in a little booth. Oh, I hear the music is having a I thought to confess was to go in a booth and somebody was on the other side with a black curtain. And I had to say, you know, I lied, I cheated, and I did this and I did that. I thought to confess was to do that, but I found that in the Word of God, to confess only goes to the level that you believe in your heart. And to confess is to come in agreement, to profess what He says, because He is the truth. He is the way. He is the life. So to me, that changed everything, because I started confessing things. When I had lack, I would confess, no, I believe He's my Lord and He will meet all of my needs. And I confess that I come in agreement with that. And when I did something that the Holy Spirit would convict me, I go to Father and I confess, Father, I repent, cleanse me for all unrighteousness. And sometimes, you know, you go through things and you realize that there's a truth that you used to believe that was a lie. Have you ever? And you realize, gee, I believed that for 10 years. And now I'm realizing that I was being taken the wrong way, that it's not what the Bible says. After 10 years. And you don't know what to do, because then suddenly you think, well, now I'm not going to believe anymore. Because how do I know that what I believe now is real? How do I know? I know because I go back to Jesus. I seek Him. He is my Lord. And I want you to know that the Lord is waiting for each and every one of us to seek His counsel anew, afresh, for every little thing. I mean, you know, don't go shopping, you know. Should I get broccoli or cauliflower, Lord? And somebody's right there by you. Excuse me, no, wait one moment. I'm seeking the Lord. I want to know what to eat. Don't do that. But for big things, don't always trust yourself. Go to the Lord. Amen. Believe that you are clothed with the armor and you have power from on high. Not only you matter, but there's some things that the Lord has put in your heart to say that's going to change even the course of other people's direction. The Lord, lately, He's been increasing the leading of His Spirit, that whatever He tells you matters. I remember being so afraid to say something to somebody. So I would just keep my mouth shut, would never say a thing. And then the Lord says, well, do you believe it or not? I said, I do. He says, well, you're not confessing. Said, you believe it, but nobody knows you believe it. Oh. So I started going to work, that's years ago, and I started just, you know, confessing the Lord. By if something good was happening in the office in front of the lawyers, I would say, praise the Lord. Because I wasn't going to praise anybody else but the Lord. So I would say, praise the Lord. But I didn't do it like I was taking the belt of truth out to, you know. I wasn't telling them, you should praise the Lord. I was praising the Lord for myself. I was confessing that now He was Lord in my life. So that they would understand why suddenly everything started changing. I started changing. I wasn't the same person. So it was funny because I used to smoke cigarettes. So I would, and they didn't want me to smoke. So I used to go outside and smoke, and I used to walk around with a little spray. So I had the spray to smell better. I had the mints to put in my mouth. You know, who I was kidding? Thought nobody could smell. So I would go outside, I would do all that, then I would walk in the office like nothing happened. And I did that, you know, the battle was maybe 3 years after being born again and everything else was changing. And I was in a church and they had the Christmas play, you know, for Christmas. And he looked at me and he said, "Oh, you would be a good Mary Magdalene." I said, "I would." He said, "Yes, you'd be perfect for that role." So I said, "Lord," he said, "Yes." So I said, "Mary Magdalene," but I was still smoking. "How are you going to be Mary Magdalene?" Smelling like cigarettes. So the Lord says, "The truth shall set you free." He said, "You don't have to be ashamed to smoke." He said, "You used to get high." He said, "You're going from glory to glory." He said, "You're not doing the things you used to do. You're not perfect yet, but you're on your way. I'm going to set you free from that too. So don't hide it." He said, "Walk in freedom." He said, "Walk in freedom in all you do." He said, "If you don't walk in freedom, how will they know what you confess is true?" So he said, "Well, when you have the victory and now you're finally free from smoking, who are you going to tell? You can't suddenly say, 'Hey, praise the Lord. Guess what? The Lord set me free. I'm smoking.' I didn't know you smoke." Because sometimes, because of the word of faith, we're told, don't tell people, you know, the confession goes to an extreme. "How are you doing? Great. Everything's going great in my life." No, you're crying at night. You're depressed, oppressed, broke, busted, whatever. So then when suddenly you have a breakthrough in your life, nobody knows. You see the extremes. Now there's some things you don't tell people, but you matter even when you smoke cigarettes. So I went to the church and I said, "Excuse me, can I talk to you?" And he said, "Sure." I said, "Well, I would love the part, but I wanted you to know I smoke cigarettes." He said, "Oh, okay." Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I was so happy, so happy. So then when I went to work, the Lord said, "Now you have to walk in truth with the lawyers." So I said, "You know, I want you to know I became saved, I got born again, you know, for them to know, you know, and the Lord is working in my life and I'm learning to walk in truth. And I love this job and I would love to keep it. And I'm praying and the Lord is helping me and I believe that one day I'm going to stop smoking, but right now I do." You know what the lawyers say? "Mr. Amber," he said, "Oh, I've always smelled it on you." And I thought, oh my God, the things that sometimes we think, you know, but the Lord wants us to walk in freedom. He wants us to confess. So you know what? I'm a smoker. So then when the truth was out and when the Lord set me free, I was so happy to be able to go to the church and talk to the person that was in the play and said, "I'm free." And he rejoiced with me. We have to be able to confess the Lord, to confess who we are in Him, but in that process to also confess who we are. There's no shame in who we are. We always have that idea that people's not going to like us as much. Well, if they don't, it's their problem. You have you have to walk in boldness and gratitude to God of the way that He made you. He didn't make you like anybody else. There's nobody else like you. And you can be proud of it. If you're addicted to ice cream, tell somebody today. "You know what? I can stay in church after service because I love to have fried chicken when I watch football. I'll see you later." some freedom. You know what? I'm dealing with a spirit of lust. We can't deceive ourselves. James says, if you're not a doer of the word, you deceive yourself. The truth shall set you free. So to me, the protection against deception is to walk in truth. To remember the belt that I have, to remember that everything that I go through, what I say, what I think, what I feel, what I believe, it all matters. Even if it's a lie, it matters because I seek the Lord. And then He shows me and He brings freedom. The key is to humble ourselves. It's not to walk in pride like we all this and all that. Amen? We walk in truth and we walk in freedom. Oh, hallelujah. I believe the Lord is going to use this word to sharpen our sword, and He's going to use us to confess the truth everywhere we go in love. In love. And we have to consider our own ways, not judge others and point the finger. Let's take care of us so that we can shine so bright that other people, they believe that God can do great things in their lives. And let's walk forward and see a mighty, mighty, mighty move of the Spirit. Amen? So look at somebody and tell them, you matter. Stand to your feet. Tell somebody you don't know, you matter. And then tell somebody it does matter. Amen? I know you have to go eat fried chicken and there's no football? The Broncos play tonight. Okay, how many people believe the Broncos gonna win the Super Bowl again? Leroy is shaking his head. I think he's saying, you are being deceived. It's not the truth. I feel the presence of the Lord. The scripture says that if we confess our sins to the elders, that we may be healed. Today, if Lois, I'm not going to use, don't record my personal ministry when I pray for people, because I would like to give everybody a safe place to, if they want to say something in my ear. I believe the Holy Spirit is going to bring healing and freedom. Hallelujah. No, it will not be on YouTube and it will not be on Facebook. No, I believe the Lord is here and He wants to use this word to give you an opportunity if you have anything to confess. And we have prayer teams, and you can tell it to me in my ear. Or if you don't want to tell me all the details, just tell me. Amen. We confess that we may be healed according to James 5. Amen. So lift up your hands and say, I confess.
I confess.
Jesus.
He's
my Savior.
He is my Savior.
Because I believe
that
He died on the cross
for my sins
and rose on the third day.
And
Lord, I believe it in my heart.
And
I believe that You are Lord.
And
I confess it today.
Jesus is Lord.
Your word is truth.
I have the belt of truth.
It matters.
I matter.
What I believe matters.
What
I think matters.
What
I say matters.
What
I do matters. And
it gives You glory.
So I surrender all.
I
confess my sins
that
I may be healed.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.